In this episode of People and Stories, we bring to you the second part of retired Assistant Inspector General of Police, Hassan Kasinje, talking about how community policing in Uganda Police helped in reshaping its views on human rights and the police circle as a game changer in realizing improved welfare of the men and women still in service.
How crucial is it in terms of wanting the police officers to do their jobs the best way they should be doing it, respecting the rights of other people and having a decent life? Vis-a-vis what, your time, at the time you joined police, I don't think the conditions were the same. Just give us a picture. I believe at your time, maybe the pay was better, I don't know. Maybe the housing was there, there was water, there was electricity for free. Today, I don't think that still applies in the force. I mean, on that small salary with maybe costs of living going high, you have to pay for power, you have to pay for water, all those utilities. Maybe you have to take your children to school and all that. How best can the welfare of the police be improved so that they can serve to their best, giving us a picture of what was then and what is today?
My first salary, when I went to training, they were paying us half. I was getting 18,000 in 1989.
How much could it do?
Well, for the 9 months I was in training, I bought myself a set of chairs. When I started working, it was 48,000. Later on, it became 80, 140, then 180,000. So salary wasn't much. But I can assure you that the welfare of anybody in civil service or anywhere is not about salary. Motivation that we get when we are working is not about money. It's not about salary alone. The salary may be little, but there were other things that improved our welfare. Housing. Each and every police officer that I had at Entebbe Police Station, there were 200 and above. All of them were accommodated in Entebbe Police Barracks. Actually, we still had more space for those coming from the airport, from the air wing. They were all staying in Entebbe Police Barracks. And the houses were okay. There was no leakage. The doors were okay. Everything. My own preoccupation was to make sure that it was clean. And at that time, we had line inspection. I had to come to your house and inspect you. Okay? It must be clean. Clean. That was one. Everybody had a house. Now, constables rent. You go to Kwania, you go to Serere, you go to in Arua, the other district is called Maracha. You go to Maracha. You go to some places in Rakai, there is a place I found one police woman. A police post was one police woman. So they are renting. Now, that means the amount of money that you give them, part of it is spent on rent. Okay? Number two, we had some kind of transport if there is a matter that has happened somewhere. There's a police station, there's a vehicle at the police station, okay? An administrative vehicle. I don't mean patrol vehicles. An administrative vehicle. It would help detectives to go, okay? We had a canteen. I actually, if you read my book, Chosen, I was in charge of that canteen for the first 2 years I was there in Entebbe. And everybody would come and get some groceries on credit, and then would discount that from your salary or something like that. So they never really had to run around and, you know, ask money this because there was something for them. Now, but also if you worked, there was an allowance. If somebody went to escort, there was some little money paid to them. If somebody was guarding, there's some money paid to them and that kind of thing. Okay. However, as we talk now, there is an acute accommodation problem in the police. It should be. This is something that we need to sort out as a country.
How did we even allow ourselves to get to that position where we say we know in our other countries they are given accommodation, they are given these basics so that they can serve, you know, in a, I call it dignified manner, minus feeling like the lowest of the lowest. How did we even let ourselves get to that point? Because at least when you mentioned your time, I think all these things were there. Why did we remove them at this point?
We didn't remove them. I think the police did not have enough money in terms of budgets to be able to put up the accommodation, the units that they needed. However, there were programs of putting different units. If you go to Karamoja, because there was a program for Karamoja, so Northern Uganda, rather. So we are able to put, if you go to Karamoja, I think Karamoja has the best housing units.
Whoa.
Yes. Yes. If you go to Northern Uganda, they also put up housing units. Right now, the housing units that are being built in if you go to Kapchorwa, you know, Kapchorwa, between Kapchorwa and there is another district. It has a new station, and barracks and some other places they are building in Rukunjiri, there are many. Now I am forgetting my facts. However, money will never be enough to put up all the required housing units. You have seen at police headquarters here, they have put a housing unit of 1,020 units. This is a huge program, but it is also a lot of money to be able to put up that. I think now there must be plans. Of course, there are plans. I know them. I know there are plans. But sometimes the amount of money given to the police in terms of putting accommodation structures is really not enough. For me, I think also there are other welfare programs like health. Police officers have also to go to other health facilities like any other person. They have to pay for the medicine and that. There are some, every police station, not every police station, but most police stations have a health unit. But that is at health center, I think two, the lowest that I have seen in the police, health center two. But they also have health center three. There are plans to put up a big hospital at Nsambia, okay? Of about 500 bed hospital at Nsambia. However, we need now to really sort out the issue of the welfare. For me, the game changer in this is going to be SACCO. Okay? It's going to be SACCO.
But we have a police SACCO already.
Yes, that is it. That's what I'm saying. There is a police SACCO with all the problems. I was the first chairman of police SACCO. I have even been to Parliament to explain what we did. Because now, it looks like police officers don't want, they think they are being forced. A SACCO should be seen as a game changer. SACCO should be seen, giving credit facilities. But I think one of the biggest problems that we have, without delving very much into the SACCO, because SACCO is also under scrutiny, access to savings. Okay? That is the problem, one of the biggest problems of the SACCO. People fear that if my wife is going for maternity or she's going to deliver, I should have some money. But when they go to ask for their savings, they say, no, you have to withdraw like once or twice in a year. I think that is what makes them abhor the program of SACCO. But go to UPDF, go to prisons, go to all these institutions. SACCO should be looked into in terms of how does it benefit police officers. Right now, they think that SACCO benefits only senior officers. They think we are the ones who go and get loans. They think it is senior officers. It doesn't benefit us. But we need really to demystify the SACCO within the police And people need to start seeing how SACCO can help them when they have issues, when they have problems. Okay? I know they are doing, the present SACCO administration under Senior Commissioner of Police Wilson Omoding, okay, is doing a fantastic job. I only wish it can be supported. I only wish that they can provide more, they should provide more opportunities for police officers to access their savings. Otherwise, it's fantastic they are doing a good job. Mm. Yes.
I love that you're giving all these suggestions to improve the welfare of police officers, because I believe at the end of the day, the improved welfare, you know, makes them serve in a much better condition. And it all goes back to serving with respect and dignity and respecting the human rights of the communities they serve and making sure that there is that good arrangement between, working relation between the police and the people of Uganda. And that brings me to you. When it comes to respect, I think you are one of those shining stars. People know you're very respectful. They always, you know, run to you when they, you know, they get a problem. You've actually become the face of the police in this country. Even in retirement, people still come to you saying, you know, maybe we need A and B and C from you. So I wanted you to tell us, how did you find yourself in that position, in that you're not the hated policeman, but you're this much loved policeman who everybody runs to if they have a problem to be solved, and how that makes you feel?
It makes me feel good. But I can tell you something. I never tried hard to be in that kind of position. I only did what was right. And I believe what was right is listening to the people. People have concerns that about the police. People have concerns about their safety and security wherever they are. People want to be helped even if it is in non-police related manner. But I think I understood how to relate with the people. And I thought that we can do much more. We can talk to people, we can listen to them, we can be part and parcel of a community, okay? So I was there, okay? I stood out and wanted, and I stood there to be counted. Whether it was a crime that was taking place in Masaka, let me say Jambia, I would invite myself, I would go there, and I would stand with the people, and I would talk to them how we can fight this Jambia.